Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I first of all have to ask for your tolerance because I am the last speaker. And I think that you would agree that I have the toughest job because you've seen, you've heard, Anupam is a very hard act to follow. And I'm sure you're all sort of itching to draw your own conclusions. But because, as everybody has pointed out this evening, we are a tolerant nation, I'm going to ask all of you to step back from the politics, the theatrics, the histrionics, and actually ask yourself, how did this become about Modi and the Congress? I didn't come here to speak against Modi or in favor of the Congress. I'm sure Anupam didn't come here to speak for Modi and against the Congress. I stand here today as an Indian citizen. Nowhere in the framing of the subject, tolerance is the new intolerance, did I see a reference to Modi? Did I see a reference to the BJP? Did I see a reference to a timeline? Did I see a reference, Suhail, to the idea of India being endangered? These are all cliches. Let's talk instead of the environment that we operate in today. And who has created that environment? Is it politicians or is it all of us? Have we as Indians forgotten the art of conversation? As a television host who presents the 9 p.m. news and goes up in competition against somebody who believes that splitting the screen into 8 boxes and then shouting the loudest is what qualifies as journalism, and the absence of nuance is what qualifies as entertainment, I worry in fact, most of all, for the intolerance of my own fraternity, the media. I worry at how somehow we have converted news into theater and our narratives have become reductionist, and I'm afraid in this city which prides itself on its intelligence, I know that all of you will agree with me that certain narratives are dumbing us down. We are more intelligent than this nationalism versus anti-nationalism narrative. We are proud Indians and we do not need anybody to certify that for us. Please tell me if you agree. Do you agree? Do you agree? Let's hear that louder. Thank you. Now let me tell you that since we have agreed that we do not need certificates, about a young man I met last night. He's about this short. He comes till my waist. He has a smile that travels up to his eyes, which I usually believe is the sign of a person who's authentic. I asked him, there's a word these days that's become very controversial. That word is called Azadi. I said, can you, to this young man, he's 28 years old, I said, can you define to me Azadi in one sentence? And you know what he said? Azadi for me is the freedom to implement the Indian Constitution. First, let me ask you, do you all agree with this definition? Do you agree that Azadi is the Constitution and the freedom that it guarantees? Okay, so who said this? A boy charged with sedition called Kanhaiya Kumar. This was his definition of Azadi. Not Azadi from India, but Azadi in India. Now, Anupam said, we are making a hero out of such people. I beg to differ. I didn't agree with a lot of what Kanhaiya said in his speech, which all of you must have seen, even though I found it mesmerizing. I didn't agree, and I don't know if it's sacrilege to say this in Bengal, but I guess not because Mamta's in power, because I'm not a Marxist. I'm actually a capitalist. And to that extent, my left liberal friends actually don't like me because there are many things about me that go militate against the left. I like the army. I cut my teeth as a reporter covering the Kargil war. I've done more than 100 shows on the Indian soldier, and I'm a free marketeer. But along with being a free marketeer, I'm also a free thinker. And the reason somebody like me believes that the government messed up badly on its handling of JNU is A, because the boy they arrested, I think they've got the wrong boy. There isn't a single documentary evidence to show that he raised any slogans about Bharat Ki Barbadi or Afzal Guru except one doctored video played out by 3 television channels who should be ashamed of themselves for reducing the ethics of journalism in doing this. Secondly, Let's assume that some slogans were raised that were disturbing. And they were. Do I agree with those slogans? Absolutely not. Do I find them disturbing? Absolutely. But what about hypocrisy? Let me tell you what I mean by hypocrisy. Jai Jai Lalita, known to enjoy a good rapport with the current government, 2 days ago passed an order that Rajiv Gandhi's killers should be released, convicted terrorists. No one called her anti-national. Prakash Singh Badal, an ally of the BJP, has written letter after letter to hardened convicted terrorists, Rajwana, Bhullar, should be released. Nobody called them anti-national. Mufti Mohammed Saeed, the chief minister of a BJP-PDP government, when Afzal Guru was being executed, wrote a letter saying that the execution had been done in unholy haste. Ye main nahi bol rahi, ye Mufti saab ne bola. Unhone aage bola ki ye jo execution hai, ye Kashmir ki history mein ek negative, Kashmir ki painful history mein ek negative reference point ban kar rahega. लेकिन बीजेपी ने तो मुफ्ती साहब के साथ सरकार बनाई. तो आप मुझे बताएं कोलकाता के लोग कि अगर मुफ्ती साहब एंटी नेशनल नहीं है, प्रकाश सिंह बादल एंटी नेशनल नहीं है और जयललिता एंटी नेशनल नहीं है, अगर बीजेपी और पीडीपी की अलायंस में एक कमिटमेंट है कि हुरियत, आप हुरियत को जानते हैं, दे कश्मीरी सेपरेटिस्ट, हार्डर्न सेपरेटिस्ट, उनकी अग्रीमेंट में एक कमिटमेंट है कि हुरियत के साथ डायलॉग होगा. So you will talk to hardened separatists as a commitment to the PDP. You will allow Jayalalitha to order a release of Rajiv's killers. Rajnath Singh will say he will consider Prakash Singh's Badal's petition to release convicted terrorists. But you will lock away 4 students for 4 slogans. Hypocrisy, hypocrisy, hypocrisy. I'm sorry, but this is sheer hypocrisy. Now the bell tells me that I have 3 minutes left. And with apologies to my friend Randeep, I want to say something here. What I want to say is that first we saw this word called secularism being corroded by competitive politics. I call 1984 and 2002 the bookends of our debate around secularism, within which both of these parties have played competitive politics and corroded the notion of secularism. Now I'm afraid the same thing is being done with nationalism. There were pseudo-secularists, now there are pseudo-patriots. And in this way, we see these slogans that we took for granted actually getting politicized and corroded. I stand here as a citizen, certainly not as a supporter of the Congress or a supporter of the BJP or for that matter any other party. I think the emergency was shameful. I think the censorship of the satanic verses was shameful. I think the way Babri Masjid was coordinated between the BJP and the Congress, with Rajiv Gandhi allowing the unlocking of the Masjid and the BJP bringing it down, both in our history have to take the blame for that. And are we going to step back? We the people who are tolerant, who want to live and let live, who want to let people wear what they want, and yes, eat beef if they want. In Bengal, you can say this, but today you can't say this in Delhi. You can't say this in Uttar Pradesh. How shocking is it that in Uttar Pradesh, the meat in Dadri, in a clerk's fridge, was sent for testing to see whether it is beef or mutton. What sort of country have we become where the meat is more important than the manslaughter? And this has nothing to do with any political party. This has to do with the politicization of all values that are dear to me as an Indian. Secularism was dear to me, my politicians took it away from me. So today I say pluralism. Nationalism was dear to me, but today the people who are expecting that we will conform to their notions of nationalism have taken away that word from me, and I will have to look for another word. And I turned to Kanhaiya, who gave me the definition, and he said, nationalism is borrowed from Europe. It's a borrowed idea based on a single entity. India is many nations within a nation. Let's use the word patriotism instead of nationalism. Let us stop this false binary that if we raise questions about how JNU was handled, we are against the Indian soldier. I am committed to the military and I reject this false binary, but I am also committed to being a free thinker, to individual liberty. And my lament today is that there is no truly liberal party in India. I wait for the day when a party would have the guts to stand up for the right of people to eat whatever they want to, dress how they want to, sleep with who they want to, love who they want to. As for questioning Supreme Court judgments, I certainly question the Supreme Court judgment on 377. So we can question Supreme Court judgments. And I will end now by quoting one of the most well-known contemporary philosophers of our time, Karl Popper, who spoke about how too much tolerance is a bad thing. And I will just read this out and then end. The paradox of tolerance. Unlimited tolerance must lead to the disappearance of tolerance. If we extend unlimited tolerance even to those who are intolerant, if we are not prepared to defend a tolerant society against the onslaught of the intolerant, then the tolerant will be destroyed and tolerance with them. We should therefore claim in the name of tolerance the right not to tolerate the intolerant. We should claim that any movement preaching intolerance places itself outside the law, and we should consider incitement to intolerance as criminal in the way that we consider murder and kidnapping. With that, I rest my motion. Of my own fraternity, the media. I worry at how somehow we have converted news into theater and our narratives have become reductionist, and I'm afraid in this city, which prides itself on its intelligence, I know that all of you will agree with me that certain narratives are dumbing us down. We are more intelligent than this nationalism versus anti-nationalism narrative. We are proud Indians and we do not need anybody to certify that for us. Please tell me if you agree. Do you agree? Do you agree? Let's hear that louder. Thank you. Now let me tell you that since we have agreed that we do not need certificates, about a young man I met last night. He's about this short. He comes till my waist. He has a smile that travels up to his eyes, which I usually believe is a sign of a person who's authentic. I asked him, there's a word these days that's become very controversial. That word is called Azadi. I said, can you, to this young man, he's 28 years old, I said, can you define to me Azadi in one sentence? And you know what he said? Azadi for me is the freedom to implement the Indian Constitution. First, let me ask you, do you all agree with this definition? Do you agree that Azadi is the Constitution and the freedom that it guarantees? Okay, so who said this? A boy charged with sedition called Kanhaiya Kumar. This was his definition of Azadi. Not Azadi from India, but Azadi in India. Now, anti-national. Mufti Muhammad Saeed, the chief minister of a BJP-PDP government, when Afzal Guru was being executed, wrote a letter saying that the execution had been done in unholy haste. Ye main nahi bol rahi, ye Mufti saab ne bola. Unhone aage bola ki ye jo execution hai, ye Kashmir ki history mein ek negative, Kashmir ki painful history mein ek negative reference point ban kar rahega. लेकिन बीजेपी ने तो मुफ्ती साहब के साथ सरकार बनाई तो आप मुझे बताएं कोलकाता के लोग कि अगर मुफ्ती साहब एंटी नेशनल नहीं है प्रकाश सिंह बादल एंटी नेशनल नहीं है और जयललिता एंटी नेशनल नहीं है अगर बीजेपी और पीडीपी की अलायंस में एक कमिटमेंट है कि हुर्रियत आप हुर्रियत को जानते हैं देयर कश्मीरी सेपरेटिस्ट हार्डर्ड सेपरेटिस्ट उनकी अग्रीमेंट में एक कमिटमेंट है कि हुर्रियत के साथ डायलॉग होगा So you will talk to hardened separatists as a commitment to the PDP. You will allow Jayalalitha to order a release of Rajiv's killers. Rajnath Singh will say he will consider Prakash Singh Badal's petition to release convicted terrorists. But you will lock away four students for four slogans. Hypocrisy, hypocrisy, hypocrisy. I'm sorry, but this is sheer hypocrisy. Now the bell tells me that I have 3 minutes left. And with apologies to my friend Randeep, I want to say something here. What I want to say is that first we saw this word called secularism being corroded by competitive politics. I call 1984 and 2002 the bookends of our debate around secularism, within which both of these parties have played competitive politics and corroded the notion of secularism. Now, I'm Anupam said, we are making a hero out of such people. I beg to differ. I didn't agree with a lot of what Kanhaiya said in his speech, which all of you must have seen, even though I found it mesmerizing. I didn't agree, and I don't know if it's sacrilege to say this in Bengal, but I guess not because Mamta's in power, because I'm not a Marxist. I'm actually a capitalist. And to that extent, my left liberal friends actually don't like me because there are many things about me that go militate against the left. I like the army. I cut my teeth as a reporter covering the Kargil war. I've done more than 100 shows on the Indian soldier, and I'm a free marketeer. But along with being a free marketeer, I'm also a free thinker. And the reason somebody like me believes that the government messed up badly on his handling of JNU is A, because the boy they arrested, I think they've got the wrong boy. There isn't a single documentary evidence to show that he raised any slogans about Bharat Ki Barbadi or Afzal Guru, except one doctored video played out by three television channels who should be ashamed of themselves for reducing the ethics of journalism in doing this. Secondly, let's assume that some slogans were raised that were disturbing. And they were. Do I agree with those slogans? Absolutely not. Do I find them disturbing? Absolutely. But what about hypocrisy? Let me tell you what I mean by hypocrisy. Jai Jai Lalita, known to enjoy a good rapport with the current government, 2 days ago passed an order that Rajiv Gandhi's killers should be released, convicted terrorists. No one called her anti-national. Prakash Singh Badal, an ally of the BJP, has written letter after letter to hardened convicted terrorists, Rajwana, Bhullar, should be released. Nobody called them afraid. The same thing is being done with nationalism. They were pseudo-secularists. Now there are pseudo-patriots. And in this way, we see these slogans that we took for granted actually getting politicized and corroded. I stand here as a citizen, certainly not as a supporter of the Congress or a supporter of the BJP or for that matter any other party. I think the emergency was shameful. I think the censorship of the satanic verses was shameful. I think the way Babri Masjid was coordinated between the BJP and the Congress, with Rajiv Gandhi allowing the unlocking of the masjid and the BJP bringing it down, both in our history have to take the blame for that. And are we going to step back? We the people who are tolerant, who want to live and let live, who want to let people wear what they want, and yes, eat beef if they want. In Bengal, you can say this, but today you can't say this in Delhi. You can't say this in Uttar Pradesh. How shocking is it that in Uttar Pradesh, the meat in Dadri, in a clerk's fridge, was sent for testing to see whether it is beef or mutton. What sort of country have we become where the meat is more important than the manslaughter? And this has nothing to do with any political party. This has to do with the politicization of all values that are dear to me as an Indian. Secularism was dear to me. My politicians took it away from me. So today I say pluralism. Nationalism was dear to me. But today, the people who are expecting that we will conform to their notions of nationalism have taken away that word from me, and I will have to look for another word. And I turned to Kanhaiya, who gave me the definition. And he said, nationalism is borrowed from Europe. It's a borrowed idea based on a single entity. India is many. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I first of all have to ask for your tolerance because I am the last speaker. And I think that you would agree that I have the toughest job because you've seen, you've heard, Anupam is a very hard act to follow. And I'm sure you're all sort of itching to draw your own conclusions. But because, as everybody has pointed out this evening, we are a tolerant nation, I'm going to ask all of you to step back from the politics, the theatrics, the histrionics, and actually ask yourself, how did this become about Modi and the Congress? I didn't come here to speak against Modi or in favor of the Congress. I'm sure Anupam didn't come here to speak for Modi and against the Congress. I stand here today as an Indian citizen. Nowhere in the framing of the subject, tolerance is the new intolerance, did I see a reference to Modi? Did I see a reference to the BJP? Did I see a reference to a timeline? Did I see a reference hail to the idea of India being endangered? These are all cliches. Let's talk instead of the environment that we operate in today. And who has created that environment? Is it politicians or is it all of us? Have we as Indians forgotten the art of conversation? As a television host who presents the 9 p.m. news and goes up in competition against somebody who believes that splitting the screen into 8 boxes and then shouting the loudest is what qualifies as journalism, and the absence of nuance is what qualifies as entertainment, I worry, in fact, most of all, for the intolerance.